San Francisco is rocked today by a magnitude 3.7 earthquake at 7:02 a.m. local time, right off the coast on the San Andreas Fault and at a depth of 8.4 kilometers. So not a big one, but actually one of the most significant earthquakes that's occurred on this section of the San Andreas in quite some time, in a couple decades. If you live in San Francisco, perhaps you felt it. There are widespread reports of shaking across the entire upper part of the peninsula. If you are on bedrock, it may have just been a quick jolt. If you are in more consolidated fill or just low-lying areas, then there would have been prolonged shaking. A lot of people are wondering, is this a precursor to a larger earthquake? Not necessarily a big one, but perhaps. So in today's video, we will explore the seismic characteristics of this earthquake and also the seismic characteristics of the peninsula so you can get an idea of what type of earthquake response you may have if you live in this area. And we will also look at the reoccurrence interval for the San Andreas Fault in and around the Bay Area. Hi everyone, my name is Stefan Burns, a geophysicist, actually from the Bay Area myself. Let's get right into it. And in fact, right now, as I'm in the middle of creating this video, there has been another earthquake in almost exactly the same spot, this time a magnitude 2.5. So now we have two earthquakes occurring in close proximity and also within just about 3 hours of each other, right off the coast of San Francisco. This is definitely a developing story. I'll keep you up to date. Now let's get back to the rest of the video. Here we have our USGS earthquake map showing all earthquakes magnitude 2.5 or greater for the past 24 hours. I have this set to show the Bay Area, going down to Santa Cruz, up into NorCal. We have the Central Valley here, even the Sierra Nevada. You'll notice San Andreas Fault right there, this red line, cutting through the Santa Cruz Mountains, right through the peninsula, goes right off the coast of the main part of San Francisco City, then goes up, creates Point Reyes and Tamales Bay, and then continues zooming on. It is a very, very long and large strike slip fault. And so the longer and larger the fault, the larger the potential earthquake that it can host. It is suspected that the San Andreas Fault can have up to a magnitude 8 earthquake and probably not beyond that by much. Whereas you need a subduction fault to get up to magnitude 8.5, magnitude 9, and even beyond. So this is only a magnitude 3.7, not that strong, enough though to give some people a noticeable shake in the city of San Francisco, which is characterized by a lot of hills. So there is quite a bit of bedrock there, but also a lot of unconsolidated fill, just a whole bunch of stuff that's been built out specifically in this area. So while that's a little bit further away from that epicenter, perhaps the shaking was even more intense in those zones because this is all just built on basically marine sediments and they put in foundations and things of this nature. So let's look at the extent of this shaking that occurred from this magnitude 3.7. This magnitude 3.7 earthquake occurring right on the San Andreas, a very large fault, allowed those effects of the earthquake to be felt over a larger area as compared to an earthquake that occurred on a much smaller fault where that energy can't propagate out as easily, can't spread out as nicely, because faults allow for the propagation of seismic waves very nicely. So we see that this energy bleeds all the way down into the Santa Cruz Mountains, even down into Santa Cruz, even though it's only a magnitude 3.7, though it's most strongly condensed right here on the peninsula. And you also see how it bleeds out as you go into the estuary system and even into like the Sacramento Delta. And the reason why is because, again, the geologic materials there, the layers, the sediments, they are just not as compacted as hard rock. And so you have this energy bleed through it much more easily. So most of it condensed right here in San Francisco, occurring right on the San Andreas. Let's look at the historic seismicity because it's quite interesting. Here we have a map showing all earthquakes magnitude 3.5 and greater going from the year 2000 to today. And I have this box set around basically the Bay Area right here. So we see that there's been quite a few earthquakes during that about 25 year time frame, though none of these have been super large magnitude. In general, the San Andreas Fault in the San Francisco Bay Area, the Hayward Fault, they are both primed and ready for a big one that has a lot of different seismologists and geophysicists and geologists worried because These areas are heavily populated. We can actually go over here and look quickly at our U.S. hazard for the area. You see that they are very high hazards going through the Bay Area as it relates to earthquakes and the shaking that results from them. But if we look specifically at the San Andreas right here, we'll notice only four earthquakes during this 20-year stretch clustered on the San Andreas. And if we click these other ones right there, that is a magnitude 3.5 that occurred in 2019. This is a magnitude 3.6 in 2002 and a magnitude 3.7 in 2023. And yeah, actually I remember that earthquake, but they're not exactly on the San Andreas. This one that occurred today in 2025, exactly on the San Andreas, and also the highest magnitude of that bunch. So quite significant, this earthquake, the strongest magnitude earthquake that's occurred on the San Andreas right off San Francisco in more than 20 years. Earlier, I touched on how the geologic setting that you're in will determine the degree of severity and also the duration of shaking for an earthquake. And so if you're on hard rock, like bedrock, then you may just experience a quick jolt from an earthquake, not a long duration or a high intensity. Whereas if you're on more loose fill, like soil or just loosely compacted sediment, then you could experience a longer duration and a higher degree of shaking from an earthquake. Here we have the San Francisco Peninsula, and we see different shear wave velocities for the top 30 meters or 100 feet. This is the average shear wave velocity. It allows us to get a site classification number. This is useful for understanding how a site will respond to an earthquake and what degree of engineering you need to put into a building to make it be able to stand up to the potential earthquake hazard. So we have some blue values here. Those are areas that are on bedrock. Those have site classifications that are quite high. And so we see that this right here has a AVS 30 of 926. Here it is 1,036, and there it's 760. So this is meters per second, and this is the average shear wave velocity in the top 30 meters of the subsurface. And the shear wave velocity is very closely connected to surface waves, which are the most destructive part of an earthquake. 70% of an earthquake is in surface waves. So if you can estimate the shear wave velocity, higher velocities being less destructive, then you can get a sense of how surface waves will interact with that zone and whether you'll have a significant earthquake event or whether it'll just be kind of that, again, that quick jolt that passes through. So there are parts of San Francisco where bedrock comes up. There's a lot of serpentine and you can build on that and it's quite nice. But there are other zones where the shear wave velocity is lower. Here we have a shear wave velocity of 460. There it is 380. Whereas if you go down into these areas, we will see that it actually goes down to 337. We have 291. You're closer to the coast. You have a lot of sand and just loose compacted sediments along the coast of the peninsula. And then if we go over here, we get a very similar story. We get values there, 191. And look at this one right there, 178, site class E. So here the shaking would be much more intense from an earthquake than a location that is on bedrock like these first three that were shown. And if we zoom out, we can actually see some site classifications for the larger Bay Area. Here we have Oakland, and in general, more the East Bay, and you see that they're all lower values typically until you get up into the hills. If you look at the coastal ranges, we see that these values here are higher. And then if we go down into Santa Cruz Mountains, we get a very similar story. So they have the San Andreas cutting right through this area. So you could potentially be right on top of the San Andreas Fault in the Santa Cruz Mountains. That's why those mountains exist. But if an earthquake was to occur, it would be more of a quick jolt. But if you look at the San Jose area, you see a lot of very low average shear wave velocities for the top 30 meters, which means that they have lesser site classifications and they're likely to experience more severe shaking as a result of an earthquake if one was to rupture. Is this magnitude 3.7 earthquake just a one-off, or is it perhaps a precursor to something larger? Here is a data graphic showing the earthquake reoccurrence interval for the San Andreas Fault, among some others, in Northern California. This is from the USGS. So we see the San Andreas Fault here coming up from Central California, cutting through the Bay Area, then going into NorCal before eventually jogging off near Ferndale. In fact, on December 5th of 2024, so just a little bit more than a month ago, there was that magnitude 7 earthquake that occurred right about here. That was one of the biggest earthquakes that we've had in a long time. And so this is showing that there has been recent large-scale activity on the San Andreas Fault just in recent history. But in general, the reoccurrence interval for the San Andreas Fault isn't that often. So we have here our San Andreas Fault cutting right through the Bay Area. Of course, there was a 1906 earthquake that was quite large. And we see that here, the reoccurrence interval is about 200 to 300 years. Whereas if you go down more into this area here near Santa Cruz, it's about 110 years. So you have an earthquake reoccurrence interval in this zone there of about 100 to 200 to 300 years. It kind of goes up in the time duration as you get closer up towards where it jogs off. And then of course the earthquake reoccurrence interval in SoCal is different for the San Andreas. You also have the Hayward Fault and also the Napa Creek Fault. And that's just been recently identified with that 2014 magnitude 6 earthquake. That was quite a shaker. And the Hayward Fault really has a lot of people worried because it had a big earthquake in 1868, and it has an earthquake reoccurrence interval of about 170 years based on different geologic studies looking at past slips on that fault. And so we're right about due for an earthquake from the Hayward Fault based on that reoccurrence interval. Though these are just averages. You can have these long durations in between. Sometimes you get a cluster of earthquakes. So you have to keep that in mind as well. So in general, we are looking at recurrence intervals that are about 100 plus years in length for these faults. And they are all basically about due to go. Maybe the Bay Area here has quite a bit longer because we do see it goes from 110 years to about 200, 300 more north of the Bay Area. But we are still now getting to the further end of that reoccurrence interval range for San Francisco. And that magnitude 3.7 earthquake has about a 5 to 10% probability of being a foreshock. That is the official statistics. If you get an earthquake and it's just kind of like a one-off, then it's about a 5 to 10% chance it's actually a foreshock for something larger, and typically that jump would be one magnitude up. So that would still only take it to about 4.5, maybe even magnitude 5 at the greatest. That is still quite weak. The earthquake that occurred in Napa 2014, magnitude 6, that is when an earthquake starts to become destructive. So we'll just have to wait and see what happens with earthquake activity in the Bay Area. We have also the Calaveras Fault, and we have the geysers up there, and there's in general quite a few earthquakes that occur in and around the Bay Area across time, but specifically for the San Andreas Fault and right off the coast of San Francisco, this is the first notable earthquake that's occurred in more than two decades. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you found this video report useful. And again, I've been your host, Stefan Burns. I will keep you up to date as to what is happening seismically in the Bay Area if there are any new updates to share. Also for California and in general, the world at large. That is what I do on this channel. I talk about solar activity, space weather, Earth geophysical events and geologic events. Also at times you look at the solar system cosmos, examine what's happening there. So if you like the sound of that, if you'd like to stay appraised as to what is happening energetically on our planet at any given moment, then please subscribe to the channel. I hope to see you around. Again, been your host Stefan Burns from the Bay Area myself. Happy to support you with understanding what this earthquake is all about and what the chances are of this being a precursor for a larger earthquake. Wishing you all well, and I'll see you soon.